Já está gravando já. Exato, já está gravando. Deixa eu voltar aqui ao
Depois
Zoom.
disponibilizas o link, não é, Filipe? Para darmos uma vista de olhos.
Oi?
Depois disponibilizas o link
Sim,
para dar também. Tá
com.
bom.
Exato.
Ok, Filipe, até já então. Até já.
Ok.
Desculpa não poder assistir, mas hoje isto está meio complicado. Tenho mesmo tratado as cartas.
Sem stress.
Ok, vou já tratar disto, tá bom? Até já então, Filipe. Até já.
Está todo mundo? Eduardo Pinho, Sara, Cisco Solange. Todo mundo tá me ouvindo? Todo mundo tá bem?
Perfeitamente.
Perfeitamente. Ok.
Sim.
Ok. Is there anyone who speak English that I might have like to speak English, give a lecture in English? Yes,
Yes,
yes, it's Michael. Michael
yes. It
Vasil,
will
sorry.
be nice.
Yeah, sorry. Sorry, sorry. So the thing is, I think right now, because I have like some international students, and in the next session will be like other students as well, I'll have like to give the lectures in English. But feel free to interrupt me, ask the question in Portuguese anyway. We have the lectures on this week. The next week we have like the question session, and this can be in Portuguese. No worries about this. But as long as I think that everyone can understand me, it's like quite easy to do this and pretty straightforward. And you can ask in Portuguese. I mean, no worries, no worries about this. And also my English is not like that good, so I think that everyone can understand, even if it's kind of like a bad, but it's okay. And I think that we can start continue. Any questions so far? Everyone has access to the Google Drive. Everyone has access with everything. Is everything set? Okay. Because this is like a heavily depend for now. And I'm thinking about it because for some data sets, for some cases, we might start to dip our toes on running locally. So at some point of the, especially in the next module that we are going to do, the data sets are quite large, are quite big, and the models are like quite big as well. So it might not be possible to run everything, but at least I will make the code so you can download it, run locally, and at least make a lighter version of the code so you can run on the Google Colab. So you will not have like to worry about have a GPU or something like this. I'm trying like to make this most accessible as possible for you guys. So without further ado, so we have like this now, we have like these changes. The main changes was like I have like a trim in my hair as well, as you have noticed. But the main change to be like the lectures will be on the Zoom from now on. All you guys will receive a certification that we will issue by Sigma. Alguma coisa? Fecha a porta aí para não fazer barulho. So everyone will have like a certification at the end of the course. I mean, I can try to manage to have like two certifications, like for the first module and the second module, but I will not guarantee this. But at least one for the full course you have. Okay? So let me start sharing screen so you guys can see my desktop. And yes, you see my desktop right now. Okay? Please, if you have any question, open your microphone. You guys cannot do this, right? You have like the permission to open the microphone and yell at me. Don't write on the chat because I cannot see the chat. But to see the chat, I have like to go here and do this. Have any question, just yell at me and I will try like to solve this. I need to make smaller out this. I will put this here so I can see myself, and because I will not have like the fancy box that I always have. So what we have here, what we have here so far, you guys have access to the Google Drive, right, everyone? So you can open like the Jupyter Notebooks. It will be like our first model. So I will try to attempt it here, like speed running here. to do the first convolutional model that I'm going to do. We are not going to explore the dense neural network and everything. Besides, next week I want to show you some more deeper understanding of the convolutions, and we have like to compare these two. But I will try like to rush a little bit and try to at least convey you the idea of using convolution and build the full model right now. Okay? So this, I think already everyone know how it's going. Like this, we have like mounted the drive and all of make the Jupyter Notebook C or a Google Drive and do all of these authentication steps. Everyone already kind of like a boring. This is like become like a recurrent joke, I think. And this is nothing new. This is things that we already have done from the past lectures. And I'm just like repeating myself here, okay? Today the model will be pretty simple. We have like two categories of images. One represents our signal, which is like the measure of the black hole. And we have like the gravitational waves and all of this. And the other just random noise from the LIGO detector. Like, actually, it's not from the LIGO Hanover, LIGO Virgo, and LIGO Virgo, no, LIGO Hanover, LIGO Livingston, and Virgo. Each one represents a color channel on the images, and have all of these fancy spectrograms and all of this. So, one thing that I strongly advise you to check first, it is like how many samples that you have like from the data set. In our case, we have like 1,000 samples for each of this class. So the data set is pretty well balanced. It's like this. Because this is a data set that Osvaldo generated for another work that we are developing, we have the luxury to have a balanced data. But this is not the real stuff. I mean, most of the case you have like very, very few examples from the class that you have interest in. So you have to be mindful about how to balance this data set, and I'm going to explore a little bit more in the next session. But just keep in mind, this kind of balanced data, like 50-50 for all of the classes, this never happens in the real life. Okay? Here we have like the same classes to the data set that we created before, nothing new for now, and we can check this. Okay? So one thing that's remember that I comment about it was, I think I'm drink too much coffee. I will start to speak really fast now. Okay. One thing that we have, like I commented last time, it was like the data augmentation part, like this, because we have all of these samples, and if you feed the neural network as the same sample again and again and again, the same size, the neural network kind of get addicted on this, and it's kind of like start to remember the features of the images itself, even the order that I'm going to, especially that I'm giving like a smaller sample, like 1,000 samples for this kind of case. To avoid these two things, like the neural net get addicted on this data, we can use these transformations like this. It's called like transforms. It's a special class on PyTorch that has like, okay, take an image. Actually, it's a class from Torch Vision. Take an image and impose some random transformation. Like random transformation, what I mean is like, okay, take an image, or maybe rotate clockwise or counterclockwise in some degree that you can establish. Take the image, flip the colors. You can do this this kind of a transformation, or just put some random noise on this on the image. You can do really, really crazy stuff on this kind of a transformation, and this is a part of like that's called the data augmentation. This is very important for the purpose that I already told you, but it's also another way that you can find, like if you have like a imbalance in classes, like you have like 1,000 images for one class that you are not interested, but like 200 images for the class that you are interested. So you can use data augmentation to kind of like inflate the images that you are interested, like this. You take like the same image and you just like impose some random transformation that we're going to do this. Besides be the same image, it will appear like slightly different because of this transformation that you impose on this. And you can give like one transformation per time, or you can do as I did here. You create this chain of transformation. What is happens just like this. A image will enter on this function here that we are creating this object. And first it will resize. Remember that's like okay, the images are like 560 by 560 pixels. These are quite big. It might not fit on my GPU on the Google Colab. So what you can do? We resize it. Instead of like do this, go make the image a little bit smaller. So you resize it for 256 pixels. Now that I resize the image, I can just like okay, give you some probability that you have. Maybe rotate the image of some degrees. In that case here, I'm using like okay, 35. 35 is the degree, the angle degree that my image can maximum rotate. The maximum rotation that I can pose here is 35 degrees. The image can be rotated like clockwise or counterclockwise. And the probability that it will make this rotation is a uniform probability. It's like it's all the same like this. The random invert, it is take like, okay, you have like the color for red, green and blue. And it might have like some 20% of the time that the image will fed this. These colors will be flipped. Will be like, okay, instead of, I think someone is trying to run my Jupyter notebook, right? So that would be interesting. So okay, this random transformation will take the image and you just like flip it randomly, like change the channel from red to green or the green to blue or anything that you can decide. This transformation will take like the image and just like okay, you have like a probability of 10% that any given image, instead of appears in the natural order that is appear, is just like flip it. Like in that case I'm doing like the horizontal flip it like this. Like every time when you call it some batches of image, 10% of this image will be horizontally flipped. Okay? And the final one is just like okay, because all of these are images, until here are images. And the machine learning model don't understand image, they understand tensors. We have to convert this to tensors. And there's a poltergeist. Someone is messing with this. Okay. So every time I do this, you convert to tensor and the images are already converted in this kind of game. And these are the way like you do a composition of transformation. Okay? Yes, it's someone running, at least open. You can run, you can open, but I advise you to copy the model. You create your folder, like here, like everyone has a folder. You can create your copy and you move that and you can run as you wish. Okay? I mean, you can run this again, but just don't erase anything or something like this, but otherwise it will crash. But let's keep continuing, okay? So let's see how this transformation acts in each one on the image. So we have like the original image here, and the first transformation, as I told you, you just, it is this image, no, this is image, yeah. You have this image here and we just like resize it. Okay? This transformation thing crop I'm just like putting here because it's like really really interesting, because what is this transformation does is just like take the original image like this and split in 5 sectors the image, like divide by 5 the image, that's like here. This is like take this image here like this. And it's split in 5. If you can check, like you can do this, and the next 5 change, do the horizontal flip like this. So it's just like This is a way also to really date augmented your sample. If you have like a specific class, you can do this like, okay, take this, do this 10 crop transformation, and instead of have like one image for that class, you now have like 10 images for free. So these are really good to do the medic in example like a medical medical classification, like image classification for medical examination. These are really good because some of the diseases like are very rare, and you don't have like so much samples, especially samples which are labeled. So we use a lot on this on the case of like in medical images. And for the random rotation, we just like as I said, like you take like this and you random rotated a image out some like some sort of degrees that you can give. And for the inverted, random inverted, so here we have like 20% of the images will be randomly inverted, and this is we have like 10 images, at least two will be like this kind of. This is the effect of the random inverter. We just like change all the color channels. We just like flip it, and we have like this kind of image right now. This can be really good because, especially for these cases, because we have like a lot of dark patches on this, and the machine learning can kind of like get addicted for these dark patches, and we can just like okay, surprise, and throw a wrench on the machine learning model, and he has like to get used to this kind of transformation, I think. And this one, it is like just the random flip, the random horizontal flip. Here we don't have, yes, we have like this one, and it's randomly flipped like this. Okay, you have like all of these normal, and one of these is just a horizontal flip. Okay. We can create this composition of transformation, and we can pass this to our data set. To pass this to our data set, in that case, I created like this argument on the data set function that we have. Remember, here we have this argument that's called transform, and every time if it has like some transformation, you take like this and run the transformation on the image, on the example image. Okay. In the fast AI case, you don't need to program anything like this. It's automatically assigned this, unless you want to impose your own transformation. So you have like to pass a list of transformation that you want, and it will understand automatically. You can even pass like this in this format that I gave to you. It will automatically do the trick for you. And you see like I take like one example here, and I'm check like the shape of this, and I can even check like the format from this, and you have like okay, this is all tensor now, everything is correct, everything is like normalized, and it is ready to go to the machine learning model. Okay, so far so good. Any question? Now is the time. I think that's is everyone really. I think I'm missing someone. Everyone got the email? Of course, if everyone is here, of course. The person that is not here will not be manifested, so I'm really suspect that I'm missing someone. Can't remember. Okay, so in any case, it will be on YouTube, so feel free. So we are creating nothing new here. We have the data set, we have the data loader, and now we can start to build our first model. Now we can really do the nice stuff, ok? Isso aqui foi atualizado remotamente em uma outra guia. Someone is running. Now we save. Well, feel free to run. I just don't understand why it's taking like. Okay. So, first thing first, you are going to create on this. So, we might also be mindful about creating like a really dumb baseline like this. If you have like the model and the model just like how good it will be our model that we're going to create compare with some random prediction. Compare like, okay, if I label everything to zero, how much we can guess like this. This is just like to compare if our model is useful or not. If your model like gives like the same prediction for the random guess, I mean, it's not like even worth the effort to build to learning machine learning, so we can automatically guess this. So, and these are just like a function. I'm just like extracting a list of values from the labels, like this inside our data set, and I'm going to try to predict on these labels after it run it, after you run this. I think that's now. It's time, like, if you have like some question or any comment or any suggestion to give, I think now it's time while it is running this really dumb stuff. Question? No one? Okay. I'm assuming everyone is up to date. This might take some time because of the internet. What is running? Why the short is taking like 87, 92? Jeez. I think it's because OBS. Yes, it might be because of OBS. Yeah, okay. So we have run here, and let's say like, okay, what is the baseline for if I put everyone to zero? So we get like 52%. Why, you might ask? Because we have like the same balanced data set. If you have like imbalanced data set, we might be like really bad prediction, but here we have like the same. And what about like the random prediction? Actually, if we predict everything zero is better than the random prediction. So this is a really dumb baseline. Okay, so we can. Okay, let's start to build our model. The way that I'm going to build our model, since it's a convolutional model, it's really important. It's really I mean, convolutions, they are really good. They are really precise. Depend on the kind of data that you have. Depend on the kind of like of things that you want to exploit on your data. If your data have like three main properties, that is like if your data has locality it means like okay, the same pattern happens to appear again and again in the same image, like this. In our case, it's like we have like these patterns that is like these green blobs and all of these. This repeat in the images like in different places. This is a locality property of our data set. So we are really good on this case. If we have like its locality, what is the second one? I always forget like the name like this, but we have like locality. If the pattern, like the image, we have like a pattern, like okay, human beings, you have like all of these two eyes, one nose, and one mouth, like normal human beings, like this. We have like this pattern, it happens, it appears in different samples. The same pattern in different samples, like this. If you have like also this property, in our case, the gravitational wave side, we have like a, if you have like a signal, we'll have like some sort of like a spike. Happens like not like this, but you have like some sort of a spike happens on the data for one sample, and other samples like this you to have like the same kind of a property. If you have this, I forgot this, it's locality, dimensional reduction, or like this. I will remember in time that is not like very maybe when I take a shower I'll remember this. But if I have like this, the pattern that happens one sample also happens in another sample, it's also good because you can explore these kind of features like of a pattern on this. And the latest one is like if the samples that you can have like a translation like this, if you like take an image of a cat and you rotate the image, it's still a cat like this. You have like this kind of like a symmetry on the data set. It can also be really good to exploit on the convolutional side. I think I wrote something here. Let me just come back. Just a really second, because I really want to remember these three puppets. Yeah, here. Stationarity, locality, compositionality. Compositionality, it is like these three features that you have like to do on a data set. You can exploit this using convolutional neural network. So the way that convolutional neural network, it's always try to exploit these three features in the maximum way that's possible, like this. So that's why convolutions, they get like so very high values on this. The compositionality, that's like you can stack a lot of convolutions, and each of these convolution will take will consider different patches, different patterns on the same image like this. So, and but the only really thing that you have like to take care is about the dimensions of the convolution. You have always like this, because convolutional operation is a matrix operation, and the output of this matrix will depend on the products that you are using, depend on the products that you are building this. And depend on the way that you set, like from output to other output. Okay, if all the layers are convolutions, it doesn't care about the output. But at some point, you have to give the predictions. And to give the predictions, you have to build this kind of a vector. And you don't know yet how it will be the size of the vectors. And one way to determine this, one way to really check this, is using this function that I put here, that it automatically compute the size of the outputs for a given convolution, like this. So in this case here, I'm using the proper definition for the convolution on this documentation, and I'm computing these outputs. So one example here, I create like this convolutional layer, like this conv2d. We are doing this, and the conv2d has like a three channels of input and 80 channels of output. In the next session, we are going like to explore like what are these channels, what are you going to do this. Right now, I'm more concerned about like giving you the tools to build this convolutional model. Okay, so once you have like this convolution, I give like, okay, if I give a image, an input image of 256 and 256, what will be the size of the output of this image, of this after this convolution? And the function computes automatically this. It will be like 127 by 127 if you perform this convolution. Okay? We are going to use this function like to check what are going the size of after all of the convolution operations, because we need this size that we don't know yet to flatten the the output from the convolutions to get the prediction. Understand? So, and how do you build the model itself? Okay, I have like this. I have the function that compute the size of the shapes of my outputs for the convolution. Okay, let me put it here. We have this, and how we can compute this? How we can build the model? The way that we build the model in PyTorch, it is using this class model. This is like a we remember that we build a class to build a data set. We will use the same kind of a philosophy to build our model. Yes, is someone? No? Okay. Okay. So we have like we define this construction. We have like the class. I name my model like CNNNet, convolutional neural network. And we are like inherited this module here. This like this. Yes. Yes, it's Mikael.
No, that was not me.
Okay. You can ask in Portuguese. Oh? Okay. Okay. So what we have here? We build this model based on like kind of like it's similar with the dataset. Remember that the dataset we build like the functions that like go to load the analysis. It will be kind of similar. First, the first function will be like the constructor, like this, how we initialize the neural network. And here we have like, I have this params argument here that we are going to build this dictionary that will feed into the model to say like, okay, how many layers I want, how many filters, convolutional filters I want, the size of this. I can always, it always good to use dictionary. I mean, believe me, it's really good. This Python is everything but dictionary. But even Python is built as a dictionary like this. If you go like to the model of the Python, the way that they structure this is always dictionary. So we are going to take advantage on this as well. So I give like these params like it will be like the neural network model parameters that they're going to feed. And the first parameter will be like the input shape like this. Remember that's like the input shape on the torch. We have like first color, next height, and next width. The same thing here. These are just like this. One parameter in particular, I put like here this num fc1. This is like the number of fully connected nodes. Yes, fully connected nodes. Like this is like the number of the neural network that we have like fully connected that we're going to create, and the number of classes that we are going to do. So the number of classes we have like two images, two classes like background or signal. So number of classes two. And this is just like a hyperparameter that we're going to explore in the lab. This is like the dropout that we can have. Like this is also another trick to avoid overfitting. And it's really interesting because me and Oswaldo in another work we use like he has this idea to use the dropout Monte Carlo stuff, which was really neat. So we can also get like some sort of like estimated error for the prediction for the neural network. This is a really neat way to do to get this. So, and here we start the convolution. We use like the NN module like this from PyTorch that has this function that's called conv2d. And if you are like if you hover the mouse here, you have like all of these parameters that like the input parameters for this convolution. Each one of these has like a really important task. We are not going to explore this right now. Next session we are going to look in detail more details about this. Okay? But the main parameters that it takes like you always give the channel. That's the nicest thing from the convolution. Convolutional because they have like some these kernel operations. They are like independent of the size of the image. You can give like any size of the image that you can put, but you have like to specify the channels. We have like the input channels, like this. We have like three, and the output channels. The output channels will be like our kernel features. Like this will be like the feature extractor, like this. So this will be like you make a little bit more sense in the next session. Don't worry about right now. I don't give any kind of a size of image. Remember like no, I didn't give like the option for the dense neural network. But the thing here is we just need like the input, the color, and the output channels that we are going to give to the neural network. And another thing that I'm giving like is the kernel size. The kernel size also has a really huge impact on the kind of a neural network that we're building as well. The kernel size, it is like the size of the operation that we're going to perform the convolution. The convolution is just like a scanning image that I'm using this. It is like this. Let me show you. This is the spoiler for the next. So yes, this is kind of like operation convolution. This is the spoiler for the next lecture. We are going to do this, and we are going to check this. So the size of the filter, the size of the kernel that I say here is like this shadow here below. Do you see? That's like this shadow that's like squaring the input. Like the blue ones are the input, or in that case are images. The kernel size is just like this shadowy region that's like a scanning over the image, and the output it is like this feature map here. Okay, but this is not for now. This is for like for next week. So we have here the first convolutional network, and here I compute the output. Start from this. Why you might ask? It will be important in a little bit. So for our model, we have like four convolutional layers and two fully connected layers. So we have like first convolutional, second convolution. If you notice here, it takes like the same input here as output before. You have like this, you are concatenating all of this together. So remember, that's like one input for the previous one. One output, the output for the previous layer will be the input for the next layer. This is the compositionality of the model. Okay? The next one will be, the output will be like two times the input features. Like this. I mean, like expanding the filters. Okay? In the next layer, remember, the output from the previous will be the input for the next one. And repeat this again, and for the last convolutional layer, the same. And you see here that I'm updating the height and width of the output. So we have this height and width for the output for the previous layer, and now we have like this for the, don't mind this, okay, for the second convolution, again the third convolution, and the last one. Why I computed this? Why I spend time computing this? Because when I'm going to flatten this, because this is kind of like a highly an image with a lot of channels, like this. This is kind of like a stacked building like this. You see, you even see like if you put like convolutional, if you put like these convolutions here, convolutions, yes, convolutions GIF. You see, no, you see that's like this, yes, you see that's like have like this. This is a kind of like a file image which is 6 pixel by 6 pixel by 32 colors, like this. So, and we have to take this and flatten it to a one-dimensional vector. We take all of this, and this one-dimensional vector will be fed into a fully connected neural network. So to do to and how you decide it, you don't know yet the shape of the final convolution. We don't know by sure. And how we can do this? We compute like we updated this height and width, and the number of neurons that we are going that we take all of this vector, this flattened vector from the convolutional, will be determined by this operation here. We just like multiply the height by width by the last channels, like this. So this is like, this will give you like the number of nodes on our fully connected layer. And we pass this to here. We just like doing this, computed this, and the number of fully connected will be the output of this, will be like the next one that we will give like for our neural network. You can give like 100, 200, 1000, whatever you wish. And the second convolutional layer, this is like which we are going to call like the head of the model. This one, we take all everything, the data your input, all of this, and it's spitting out the predictions, like a kind of like the prediction, the prediction layer. This is called like the model head, like this. And we are giving this like the number of fully connected. It is like the input. Remember, the input for the next layer is the output for the previous layer is the input for the next one, and the number of classes. Okay, this is the model part. This is like to construct all the model you have like this, and this is the data flow part. So how the data will flow through the neural network model. We have like to define this. Okay, in Fast AI you don't need to do this, it automatically does this for you. However, if you have like another model that like I was exploring with João, that it has like, okay, you give like an image and you give like some kinematic features. Yes? I think okay, if you have like this kind of like a fancier model, or even fancier, if your model accept like two types of images, or like a, you give one image and you split the image in half and you give like these two images to these two parts of the image for one kind of architecture and other kind of architecture. It will be kind of cumbersome to implement these kind of models in Fast AI. You can do this, but it's like a really, really cumbersome to build this kind of problem. Or you can just like build the model here on the PyTorch, on using like this kind of a class, define the flow that we have here, and give it to Fast AI to train. You can do this as well. But here we are implement by ourselves. Okay, we are doing like the MacGyver style of machine learning. Okay, and this is like the data flow. The data flow is just like this. I will receive a tensor, an image from the training model. We are like we receive this, and we are passing to the first convolution we define here. And this output of this convolution, you take like this output, it will pass it through this ReLU function. This ReLU function is the non-linearity part, like this. This is like the things that make the neural networks works like not works properly, but like give you the flexibility of the neural network to operate on any kind of data set, like this. So you have like this ReLU, which takes the output from the convolutional and squeeze into some activation function, we're going to this, and give the output. So the new output, like we updated the x. So this new output, we will pass it through this pooling layer that we're going to explore on the next session. This is just like to normalizing and do this. And after pass this, we're going to the next layer. Do you see here? We have like this data flow that we take, go to a convolutional, go to a activation, and update it. Pass to a pooling layer and go to the next one. This is the data flow that you can do this. And here you can do like really crazy stuff. You can take this, you can like flip it, the data, you can assign some random number. This is the part that's called like they mostly call like a boilerplate. Because this code is alive, you can change this anytime that you want or any way that you want. As long as it not crashes or you obey the dimensions, you do everything that you want. And it you can run, okay, like this. So here we have like the convolutional data flow, like this, with all of this. And here we have like the fully connected and the classification part. The fully connected will say like, okay, after we pass the last max pooling, it will pass like the last convolutional, the last ReLU, and the last max pooling, flatten this model, flatten this, because we have like that image, remember like this, we have like this kind of thing here, and you need to flat like this, and you just like give this view option. Remember that say like, oh, we use this a lot, like to reshape and to do this. So you do this minus one, it says like, okay, wherever the first dimension is, which usually batches, this is the first dimension, wherever the first it is, change it in the way that make this dimension fix. This is the way like to flatten model. You can use like flatten as well. You can use like other kind of like operation. This is like the most Pythonic way, or the way that you can really see what I'm doing. After this, pass through the first fully connected layer. Apply the dropout set on this output, and after this, pass the last fully connected. And the output from all of this data flow here will be passed through this log softmax. Okay, why a log softmax? We're going to see in an instant. Okay, any question? I mean, this is kind of like a really scary. I mean, from people who don't know how to code, how to do this, this is kind of like a really cumbersome and really like not like that efficient. But you can build other models, you can be like a sequential models or anything like really smart. But this way, I think that is the best way so you can visualize and understand what I'm doing, right? So, and okay, we have the model here, and we are going to pass to build that model. We are going to do this. So, to build that model, remember that you create like one of the arguments is the parameters for the model. And this is like the parameters that I put, like the input shape, the initial filters, that's like this, like the output that we're going to use, the number of fully connected nodes that have number of class, and a dropout rate. Okay, for now ignore the dropout, but I'm going to explain in the next lecture. So we created this dictionary and we create the model. We just like, okay, take the class accept as an argument a dictionary, and it automatically build it for us. So voila, lo and behold, we have our first convolutional neural network model. That's really great. I mean, you can even like bragging about this. Oh, I just like created my first convolutional neural network model, and no one will cares. So okay, so right now the model that we created, it lives on the CPU. And as you already know, I don't like to do stuff on the CPU. I like to do the stuff on the GPU, which is more fast, more efficient. And we have this access here. We have like a free GPU. Of course, it's not like a 1390. It's not like this. You will not be able to run Cyberpunk like in full setting. But you'll be able to at least run this model and at least train a little bit on it. Okay, so we move our model to the GPU with these two CUDA. So these two has two functions. One is to change the data types. Remember that I showed you how, okay, if it's a int value, we can change it to float by using these two, and also to change the device that the model is located. The device, I'm telling, like the device can be a CPU, the model will run on a CPU, or a GPU, the model will run on a GPU, right? And we can even test this model. We can even see like, okay, I created this fake batch here using this unsqueezing function. This unsqueezing, it will just like take the any tensor that you want, and you can like squeeze a new dimension on this tensor like this. You can just like do this kind of like a unsqueeze operation, and I use a lot. Pode trazer água, por favor? And I use a lot on this to create this fake batch to at least see if my model is compiled, is everything, or if I miss some dimension or anything like this, right? And we can just like do this and check, right, in this fake batch. Okay, if I miss some feature, if I miss like some dimension, if you run like this, it will automatically crash it. It's like give like it would complain a lot. But since it's give like this, okay, it give like these two outputs for this fake batch. This is a really quick way to debug your code. Okay, try to use this. Try to get used on this kind of like for debug operation. And okay, we define our model. Right now we can go to the next section, but I think that we should like take a little bit of break, like 5 minutes, if you will, or end the discussion a little bit more. If you have any question, just like this, I just like take a 5 minutes break before we go to the next session, which will be like the training, the objective, like the loss function, the training loop, like this. Okay, we can do a pause right now. Okay, I'll pause the record. Okay, so after the break, the really short break that we had, so we have like to define this. Oh, okay. Sure. Sorry. Let me share my screen again. You are just seeing me, not the screen. Okay, so what we have? We have our model, and our model, the output of our model, it is like log softmax. What is this log softmax? Let's check this. Let's go there. PyTorch. The documentation is our friend. Let's go this. Not logo. Okay, just don't be stupid. Okay. We go to the documentations and we go to here. Are you listening my computer? I think so. I think that's better. I can put like the microphone, otherwise it'll just like be background noise.
There's not a lot of noise, it's fine.
Okay, can you listen me now?
Yeah.
Okay, so great. So go to the documentation and you have like this docs PyTorch. Okay, fine. By here you go. What is log softmax? Oh, you have like any functional log softmax. Okay, applies the softmax followed by a logarithm. What is the softmax? Is this it kind of like a squashing the outputs, because the outputs of the operation for the neural network, it is a matrix operation. If like take all of the numbers that you are going to do and they perform all of these crazy matrix operations like this. However, we want this to become like some probabilities, some values of probabilities. We want like to associate this kind of thing. And to do this, we take the output, the final output, and pass it through this squashing operator, this activation function that's like this. And the softmax layer, it as the name implies, like this, it's operated like this. Yes, they have like tangent hyperbolic, half sigmoid. No. It take this operation and put it to a softmax function and convert it to a probability. It will be like a number between 0 and 1. It will like take any crazy number and just like normalize between 0 and 1. And if you take the logarithm of this probability, if you remember here, it will be like the logarithm likelihood that you have. And say, that's interesting. You are converting the probabilities, and after you are like taking the logarithm of this. See, you see here, this operation here will give like a number between 0 and 1. And if we have here, we are taking all of the outputs from the neural net and converting this logarithm of probabilities. Because I'm very interested on use, depend on the way that we choose the loss function, and the loss function will be like our main guide to path to build our model. Like, not to build our model, but like to estimate our model, like this. So we have like the logarithm of the probabilities, and one option that we have, like this, like the number of, you all have like to take into account like how many outputs we have like for the classification, sorry. In that case, we have like the, for the classification, we have like two outputs. It could be more outputs, like three, four, five, and six. But you have like to thinking about how we can do this kind of like of a performance. But in that case, we have like two, and the output are the log of the probabilities. The best activation function that can happen here, it is the negative log likelihood. Remember that's like this. We are like trying to take all of the data, and we are like to maximizing, like not maximizing, we are minimizing the negative log likelihood of the predictions, like this. And when you are minimizing this, we are like maximizing the probability of our model, like this, giving a correct classification, like this. I mean, it's kind of like a really cumbersome way to do this, but actually, this kind of a way like make the log softmax and negative log likelihood is not, people does not does this anyway. People does like the cross entropy loss, which automatically do this for you. It is more stable, but for purpose of explanation, we have like we are going to use this kind of example. Remember, the output of our log softmax is the logarithm of probability, and our objective function is to minimize the negative log likelihood, like this. So we are have like to build this kind of a structure like to do this. And because I'm using this this kind of a loss function that we want to minimize the negative log likelihood, we can also check, we can also like see, because we are feeding batches as well to the loss, we can see if the loss has like, okay, we can compute the negative log likelihood for the full batch, like this, or for individual examples of the batch and take the average. And this is like computed in different way, in different forms, by giving this reduction parameter. Like this. This reduction parameter is just like, okay, do the computation of the log softmax for each one of the examples of the batch. Later, sum everything and give me the number, give me the output number. Okay? If you want, like, not sum everything, but giving like the average for all of this, we just like put here, instead of sum, we put like mean, like this. And this will give like other number. This will give like the average of the negative log likelihood on that batch. Okay? These two kinds of philosophy, they give like slightly different performance in depending on the problem that you are analyzing. Depending on the problem of this. For some cases, it will be preferable that you give like the sum for this. For other cases, it will be like preferable that you give like the mean. For the cases that you have like example, like a lot of number of classes. If you have
Okay.
like
Would it make sense to, if your data set was more chaotic, if your likelihood for each element of the batch, if the spread was higher, then maybe the sum would be better because you'd be able to like optimize the model to get a lower spread.
Yes, you can do, you can think on
Right.
about this, or you can, if you have like 1,000 classes like this, so it will be really computational expensive to take like the log likelihood for each one of these and take the average for this. It will be like this. It's better you just like sum everything together and don't give a shit about this.
Okay.
Right. So. But yes, you have like to be mindful about like these kind of details as well. This can be like really make a lot of difference depending on the data set and depending on the problem that you are investigating this. Right? Also, like if you are doing some regression as well, maybe it's not like that really useful use like the sum. Maybe like the average because they're doing regression for some set. And you can have like this moving average on the loss as well. You can also
But
like.
then, when you're, would that apply to root mean square loss as well then?
As far as I remember, it is.
Okay.
Let's see here in the loss. Let's see. MSC loss.
Oh, yeah, that's it.
Yeah. You see?
So, yeah, by default, it does mean, okay.
So, okay. We define here and we just go. I'm just go over on this kind of this. This is just like one example so you guys can check how these values can change this. I would recommend like to do this. And here we have like the way that it happens when we're going to build the loop training stuff. It is like this. We have like the loss, we compute the loss and we do the gradient over this loss. To do the gradient over this loss, it is this command here called backward. When you do this backward, it automatically says, okay, in the loss, we have like this kind of like a small neural network. We have like all of this. And this neural network has to change these parameters to adjust the loss, to minimize the loss. And how, what it can does, what the PyTorch does this, is using this autograd function. Like this, the autograd you take like all the parameters that you have like on the neural net, like the weights and bias and everything, and you to derivate these parameters in respect to the loss, like this, because the loss is a function from the neural network and another network is a function of the weights and bias of the parameters like this, I have like this, and you take the gradient of the loss in respect with this weight of the bias and you run over the gradient on this. And to do this function, to do this like a gradient over all of this, the order is like this backward. This is like the order to say like okay, do the gradient, do the chain rule stuff. And when we do this, I mean we can see how it change on the parameter side. This is like the change of the parameters on this small neural network that we created here, like this, which has like one activation function and all of this. So another thing that we need it is optimizing because we have this, we have the loss, and we want to change the weights and bias in the best way as possible to minimize this negative log likelihood. One way you can do this is change by hand everyone and depend on the size of the model, will take like a time greater than the decay of the proton, which is like take a lot of time. I don't know if you guys have like this disposition, but I don't have it. Or you can use a function, a optimization function, that say like, okay, instead of it test every possible of this, just test a few of this. A few of this parameter, the change of the first parameter, that point you towards some directions that you say that's like okay, if I go in this direction of the model, if I change the parameters of the model in this sense, in this way, we are going to a better place. We are going to do this. Instead of change everything at once and everything like it tests all the possible combinations, we can change the combinations that at least point me towards some direction that is kind of be good. Like this. This is the stochastic gradient descent. Like this. So we have like this SGD, the stochastic gradient descent. We have like a lot of optimizers. You can check this here on the TorchNN. No, it's Torch Optim. See, yes, here. And you have SGD, which is the stochastic gradient descent, the Adam optimizer. In the next session, the next lecture, we are going to explore a little bit more what these kind of things are do. But the sense that I wanted, like you want to convey, is just like this. We have like all of this weight, and you have like to change all of these crazy guys at once, or at least change some a little bit of this, to point it towards some direction that I feel that's going in some way, in a better place to give like better predictions on this. And this is done by this optimizing function. The optimizing function, we take like the loss value, we take the parameters, and look at the gradient for this and say like, okay, change this in this way that give us like the better optimal position. In the next session, because we are doing this during the training phase, we are changing this a lot on the training phase, and after the next batches, after the end of the epoch, we have like some estimation and we update the optimizer. We do this. Okay, we updated the optimizer. Yeah. And another really neat thing that we can use a lot, instead of like, okay, the optimizer will do this kind of a gradient, and the gradient we're going to this step forward, like this, we change like this. But we can take like bigger steps or smaller steps. We can do this kind of like this. And depending on the size of the steps, it's called like the learning rate. Because you can change your gradient, you can change the parameters very, very small, like take like the numbers and change it like 10 to the minus 12, 10 to the minus 20, like this. And it will take a lot of time to train your model to reach at some point. Or you can change the very big steps. But if you put like very big number, you can change like a lot. You might overshooting the optimal position. You might like, okay, when you like reach really close to this and you take the next step, you pass over like the optimal point. And the neural net, like the accuracy will drop. Like the neural net will give like not really good predictions. And you have like to come back over. And depending on the size of this step, like the learning rate that you have, you always like overshooting the minimal position, you always like being in a bad place. So one way to overcome this is like, okay, during my training, don't use a so big step. Use like a smaller step here, but use like a larger step there. You can try to do this dynamically, change it by doing this. And you change it dynamically using this learning rate scheduler, like this. So here is one example that it would like you to change the learning rate after reach like some point. If the neural network doesn't give any good prediction, we'll divide the learning rate to the half of this. So let me just show here an example. So here's just like a dummy example that we have. We have like in epoch 22, we have like this learning rate here. For the next 20 ones, it will be like half of the initial learning rate, and later half of the initial. You understand? Like we are like taking like really big steps at the beginning, and later we just like, okay, divide the step by two, and later divide it by two. You can do this kind of like learning rate scheduling like this. This also like has a really huge impact on the time that we're training the neural network, and also the precision that's like doing this. Because you can take like, okay, start with really big steps and go like a very, very small step, and you rapidly converge on the beginning of the training, but when you reach the end, it become like a slower convergence like this. So there are other ways to do this. Like it has like the cyclical learning rate, which is the one that we mostly use. And this you can have like a you can train like for 12 epochs, 20 epochs, and you have like a 100% of accuracy really quickly. This one is like it take like a you can train like for 100, 200, depending on the way that you want. Okay. And somewhere I only have like more 10 minutes. So I'm going like to brush over this, and the next section we're going like to details on this. These are just like a create like these functions that will help me on during my training loop, doing like this. So one of these functions is like compute the metrics on the batch like this. Let's say like okay, take the predictions and how accurate are these predictions on this batch. And we are going to use this to update our model and update everything that we want. Take this and also compute the loss. So you can compute the loss on a batch like this. It is this operation here. So these are some details that I will left for the next session, but especially this one, this is like really, really important. And but I will explain on the next one because we don't have so much time right now. I spend like too much time talking about GPU, but okay. This is another function that's like, okay, I build these two functions and you say like these functions, what it takes? It takes like take the batches that we have, like this from the data loader, move to the GPU, like the X and the Y, like the features and the labels, compute the output, compute like the log probability from the model, like this, and we estimate the loss of the batch and the metric of the batch, like this. And if this is like sanity check or something that we can like the I put this like more for debugging the code like this. And if update the value of the loss of the metric divided by the size of the batch like this. This is like take the average of the loss on that batch. This is like this. This is really, really useful function, right? Because I can call these really, really things in here and directly and estimate it during my training loop. And it returns for me the value, the average value for the loss on that batch, and also the metric. The metric here is the accuracy. I'm computing the accuracy. I can put like other metrics as well, but for now we are computing the accuracy here. And I define another function here that I created, which we take like these parameters, all of these parameters, and here is the main important stuff. So it will make the epoch here in the number of epochs that I can give, like I can train like for 100, for 10 epochs, 2 epochs, do all of this. It will use that function that we defined before. We define here. Did I run? Yes, I run. To compute the train loss and the metric on this. It will store on these two dictionaries that we are creating. It will store these values here. And it will also evaluate the model. The evaluation of the model is like this. During the training, I can change the weights and bias wherever I want. But during the evaluation, ideally, you don't want to change this value. You want like to freeze this and get only the predictions. To give the order to the PyTorch to say like, please, please, don't change this. Okay? You have like to pass this. You say like, okay, model in this time is in evaluation mode, is in evaluation settings, like this. And it's already okay. Don't change the parameters, don't change the weighted bias at any cost. And to be even more emphatic, that I really want to do, to like, is to say like this, with torch no grad. A swift touch no grad is another emphasized way to say like, okay, don't change the things, please. And you compute the loss on this kind of settings like this. This is the evaluation loop. If you don't specify this here, or even this here as well, I'm doing like double security here. If you don't specify this, if you compute the loss, it will change the model. It will change the weights and biases. So it is not good for us to get like the predictions on a model that can dynamically change. So especially that we are doing the validation set like this. Okay, this here is just like, okay, if you find a best loss, we are computing the loss. If you find one that is best that I already have, save this model. Save this and take this updated. Take this. Keeping updated this kind of loss. Okay? And this is just like, okay, I'm doing this kind of like every time when he find a new loss that is like really, really good, He just like save the model and store the weights and bias there, okay? And here I'm updating the learn head shadow because the learn head shadow, remember that we change it dynamically. It needs to know at what step of the training we are in. So it reads always like it always like to know, okay, I'm in the epoch something and I'm learning height tall. I needed to change this because it doesn't change from the last 21 epoch. So I will just update it here. And this is the updated model. Okay? And also if it change here, if the learning height is changed, I mean if you find like this and you're like okay change here, it will automatically load again. I mean I'm using transfer learning with my own model like this. Every time when I change the learning rate, he goes, okay, I changed the learning rate, so it's better like take the best model we have before. Take this, load the best model, and continue the training. Okay? And at the end of the day, at the end of the training, it will return for me my model, the history, the loss history, like to make our plots, and the metrics, like this. So, let me just run this function. This is the main function that I use for training evaluation. This is like the training loop stuff. This is like really the things that you do. I would like make some debug model something, but Sysa don't have time and hashtag you only live once. So I'm just like run this thing in this way and hope it doesn't break. Okay? So it might take some time here, but I will let it running so you guys can see. And yes, luckily it passed all the compilations and everything, and it's run the model. It takes a little bit of time, but I can show you this model here in another data set. I have it. And yes, let's see here. Yeah. Okay. Oh, I forgot to run. Okay. Okay. So you can run later. You can let like a copy and run this. And you see like you get like an average of like 78-83% of accuracy like this in only 10 epochs. Which is really good. I mean this is not like any kind of like a really easy problem to solve. This is like a really challenging problem. 78% is it like it not put like on the top 1%, but it's really good. It's something. And remember we only have like four convolutional layers. For the paper that we did, Oswaldo, it was which has net that has like 98-92% of accuracy. Which Oswaldo, are you there? Well, I think it was ResNet 50 or something. I don't remember right now. But yes, here we have like the history, so it's still running there. After run this cell, we can run this cell here, and you will see here like the accuracy like 75, 78. It will be like it will reach like this kind of range that we are expecting this, and. But we only train like for 10 epochs like this because it's like take a little bit of time to do this. I would suggest you guys like to go see this notebook, this Jupyter notebook, copy to create your folder. You can create here as all the your friends like creating, create your folder, copy the notebook to your own folder and run there. If you have like some question, if you can run in the it broke or something like this, they have like some please write a comment on the cell. You can like do this. You can write a comment on the cell here, and I can go and check after this. Okay? But I think that's so far so good. We survived it. Okay? And yes, it was right on time. Okay? Question? No questions? So, let me stop sharing here. I think that's all for today. I don't know if anyone wants another comment or wants to add in more stuff or asking more from me. In the next lecture, we are going like to understand a little bit more why these convolutions operate, how these, and what are the advantages to use convolutions instead of using simple neural network connections, I think. But I would recommend like a go. Copy the notebook and try like to reproduce what I did. Try like to go to the code that I use in like the functions. Try to understand, well, what is this train value function doing? What I'm trying to do this. The way that I build it is just like, okay, we have like to do this kind of all of this crazy computational loop and everything. Break all of these into smaller functions and inside the main one that you do this, you call it this smaller function. I know that it seems like very cumbersome to do this, but we are building from scratch. We are building the models like from scratch. You can use a fast AI to do this like almost like mindless and automatically like this. But I mean, it's easier to do, it's easier like this, but let's say like if you want like to do something more fancier, more sophisticated, you might have like to do this by yourself. So and by doing this way that I'm doing, that I'm showing to you here, it is like the best way to do this, like to learn. Okay? I hope you all have liked this, but the next section will be like a little bit more theoretical and more it will be not so practical on the side, but it will be like only for the next lecture. For the next one, we come back to the more hands-on and code stuff. Okay? Questions? No one? So, okay, I think that you're all free now, right?
Thank you for the lecture.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Next section will be in 2 weeks, is it?
Yeah, the lecture will be in 2 weeks, but the next Friday will be like the question sessions, and we can also talk about more on this stuff, okay? But the
Okay.
next lecture will be in 2 weeks, right? If I have like some changes, I'll write an email to everyone, and we might, because in next 2 weeks we have like on the same time we have like the gravitational group. The GGD group, which you also guys are invited to participate as well, if you want. I mean, it would be really good to participate, to see what kind of a research we are doing, to discuss and just like keep in touch with everyone. Okay? So I think that's all. I think that's.
Okay, thank you, Felipe.
Okay, thank you. Have a nice
Yeah,
weekend.
bye.
Have a nice weekend, everyone. Take care. Okay, and
Bye,
I
Felipe.
will upload on YouTube like later, right?
Obrigada, Felipe. Foi ótima aula.
Oi, Anne. Oi.
Hi, Felipe.
Obrigada, foi ótima aula.
Obrigado também, Francisco. Obrigado.
So, can you help me now with the cluster problem?
Well, what is the problem by itself? We are like trying to install CMake and all of this. What is like?
I'm trying to install Higgs bounds and Higgs signal,
Okay.
but in order to do that, I need a newer version of CMake. It's like a 3.1 or something, and
Yes.
the cluster has the 2.8.
Okay.
And I cannot install it with the binary, so download CMake and install it,
Okay.
because they have a very old CMake version. No,
Okay.
they have a very old C++
Yeah.
version.
João, tu já usou isso, João? João Pinho, acho que não tá, tá. Ok. Jorge, do you have like same similar problem? Do you have like this on the cluster or not? Do you use like the CMake new one or not? Oh, I think Jorge.
Are you?
No, Jorge is not like this. Okay, so one thing for sure, you have like to contact the administrator and explain this, because you need like this specific package where like you cite this. Which course it is, like in the University of Aveiro or in the, which one is, or the
Lund cluster University? Is the Aveiro one.
The Aveiro one, right? So
yes.
You have like to contact, like, I think that is Barroso, I don't know, I think that is, and explain that's like, okay, I need, I really, really need this version of C and this CMake on my account. How can I install this? Because for this, they can create a module. I think that's the easiest way that they're going to do this is create these modules. That's like, and you can just do a module loader. Another thing that you can test like this, if you have like Anaconda, let me show you. Let's start to show. Am I still okay? I'm still recording. Let me just stop recording. Mm-hmm.